Like the Oscar. The anxiety doesn't go. So as a writer, sometimes you have, a lot of times, you have frustrating periods, and as an artist in general, when you feel like nothing's happening, or when you are struggling with something, when you're struggling to get something done. And sometimes, a phone call or an email will fall into your inbox at the right time. And I must say that this evening was the right time for me. I'm for those of you who don't know me, I'm Miriam Kandeya. I have published two books. They are here. But I'm also a lot of other things. I'm not just a writer. And I'm going to attempt to show you who I am through my poetry. So to speak, I am standing naked here before you, and I'm going to tell you about myself, about my anxieties, about my passions, about why I write. And if you are a writer, a lot of people have asked you this question. So, Miriam, tell me. Obviously, they've used your name and not mine. Tell me, what do you write about? And I'm always like this, you know. I write about everything. I write about my life. So I cannot answer that question. Or I can. I mean, I'm going to. But please don't ask me that question again, because I'm going to explain it to you today. Sometimes I write weird things, but they're not weird to me at all, not at all. To me, they make perfect sense, but you just have to be there, you see? You just have to be me at that time. So, Lost in the Zoo is a very good example of this, because it sounds like something strange, but it is not, because I was lost in the zoo. And I'm saying it exactly as it is. Your skin stretched hard, so clear considering your age. Trying to take a selfie with a giraffe that stuck my hand in its mouth. But that was years ago. You didn't know me then. And now we have 4 million years of eyes between us, only gazes of what might have been. And we know the potential is there, and we're not going to grab it. It's feeding time for the lion cubs. And you cannot call something cute when it's eating a rabbit hole. Blood on its light fur and the noises, those noises of greed and hunger, and nothing will come in its way. I devour the scent of your lips, fruity and secret. And you lost me in the butterfly house, purposely, because you wanted to lose me somewhere beautiful. For the rest of the time, I work on art projects and I write, and sometimes I give creative writing workshops. And I like to practice what I preach. So if I stand in front of half a dozen people and I tell them, no, you need to write, you need to write, you make time to write, you need to go to exhibitions, you need to give yourself an education. So sometimes I sit at home and I do the things that I've been preaching to others. And this is an exercise where I basically don't think. I get a pen and a paper and I write any word that comes to my head. And it actually kind of formed a poem. So here it is. It's called A Moment Too Soon. It would never be a moment too soon. I love you, stuck in holes and crevices, stuck deep in duck-down pillows, hotels that need dusting. For programs on TV, you must increase your viewership. In jest, I struck the weatherman. He said he knew it would be too soon. Imminent is the word he chose. Between scattered showers on the sun rising, while everyone still sleeps. So So as you see, sometimes without thinking, you can even write something that kind of sounds like a poem. Lily's Fruit is another strange one. I promise after this they will be less strange. But I love them when they're strange. They have a special place in my heart. Lily's Fruit was written during another event that I occasionally organize, which is called Le Salon. Le Salon invites like-minded people to socialize, and there is usually a topic, a theme. It is inspired by the French salons of the 16th century, where a woman would host a number of intellectuals, let's say, so even mathematicians, lawyers, doctors, whatever, who would meet to discuss. This was the time when women weren't allowed to go to bars, remember, so it was important for these intellectuals to meet and discuss. And there were a lot of geniuses going to these places that later, you know, became famous and popular, invented stuff that we use nowadays. Anyway, back to my poem. I wrote this poem with snippets of conversations that we had during that long day in Gozo, where the topic was food and literature, Lily's Fruit. "You must spit it directly into the earth, without touching it with your hand," she said. "Dance on the leaves like you mean it, and the magic would happen. I would grow this tree for you. Honey would seep out of its thick bark, and it would smell of sweet temptation. We'd sit in its branches, and when we couldn't make love out of sadness, we'd eat and eat, until we were full. We'd make it our home, climbing in and out like wild children with parents who didn't care. For dinner, we'd dig up potatoes and sit peeling them over stories and secrets until it was dark." So that's really sweet. I really love Inizia Mezzo Open Mic because, one, I've made a lot of friends in this room, and I feel comfortable, basically, and I feel like I'm with people who want to listen to poetry, music, short stories, sometimes comedy. And so that's why I was, you know, so pleased to be here. And it also is a great challenge to write something new about the topic. And many times we are talking about current affairs. Now there are lots of things going on. The news is at our fingertips all the time. And so these are three poems that I wrote on what's happening. The first one is called Scusi. This is also related to my job as a pharmacist. Scusi. Qed nistħi minnek, alla volja dan xogħolok. Però niddejjaq ngħidlek, għalluni. M'għandekx għalfejn sinjura tilla, min kollox smajt diġà, ma tkunx l-ewwel darba żgur. Għax għandi sola biskużi bili. Skużi skużi f'dan il-pajjiż għaddejthom il-krejns. Ħamsa skużi sitta jiena ġejja sawk. Bis-sola qomt dal-ogħdu. U skużi joqtolni dawn it-torok kollha skużi ħofor. Imkisrin u skużi imħarbtin. Imbasta nibnu skużi ħajrajs. U tajn nifsu mal-art bħal kulħadd. Kull xorta ta' sir, ta' kull nazzjonalità. Iskużi kulur ma jimpurtax. Għax-xorta waħda trabu ilma jibqa'. Warn you that I'm going to be reading in Maltese and English, but I guess you realize by now. I'm doing this all in reverse, guys. But I really love being bilingual, and as I grow older, I appreciate the sounds of both languages. Later I'll be reading some prose which mixes the languages a little bit, which is the way we speak, really. I live with an American man, but my family is multi-speaking, but I grew up in a firmly English-speaking school. My family has a lot of mixed, you know, Russians and Dutch, and so languages are everywhere in my life. The next poem is called Diaspora. Diaspora is written about a dance piece. Sabahni bil mawj, orakli jrihi bil melh, helwahi bil bariya, sabiha, isserhek. Zomli idi, atili aineya, anerek fik, matafnish. Ma tafx li nħobb nom fil-font biss. And so we are talking about the sea. Like Liana, I'm an island girl and the sea is a necessity, and I have been known to scream and shout, even though I know it's closed. Quite a few of my poems involve the sea. And one of my favorites is "You Smell Like a Memory of the Sea." Incidentally, this woke me up in the middle of the night. I'm so glad I got out of bed for this one. "You Smell Like a Memory of the Sea." And I remember which day you swept me off my feet, but gently, a toe still drawing lines in the sand. And another new poem about the sea. Alp Tofra El Melch. Alp Tofra El Melch, Issegwik Mashat Bin Mort. Imshayt Lura Al Post Failed Aina, Haris Lake Bin Bort. Kabbartek Denmi, Zammejti Distanza. Hallejta Shita Tinzal Fuqi, Riħa Ta' Sajf. Go to read a short piece of prose. There are 11 boathouses, 11 of us, lounging, sitting, crouching in the little terrace, sharing bread with tuna, pops the saint, cock, anta, tehelwana, tatsa. My dad with his sweet tea, grandpa with black coffee from a little glass, my two brothers were playing marbles. I wasn't allowed to touch those marbles because I was too young and I didn't know how to play, apparently. I dreamed of turning 10 and being considered a young man. Issa tikber. Dad has promised that I'd be able to have my own fishing rod then at the start of summer, just after school was out. That was around mid-June, when bags upon bags would be packed into the family saloon and off we'd go into the dusty roads. The summer was a long, hot, sandy, salty dream. It was chats that lasted into the night, furtive looks at the girl next door, laughter and teasing. Each summer felt infinite. My spitcha out. The first week of our stay at the boathouse was perfect. Mom and grandma would get everything cleaned. They'd hang up the curtains, make it feel like home. For a whole week, our father wouldn't go to work, so he joined us and grandpa on the games. Our skin would get wrinkly and tanned and we wouldn't leave the water except for when we got hungry, or the ice cream truck arrived, and later for a siesta. 11 awkward minutes as we sat down at the dinner table before anyone started to speak. Over the last few years, things had changed. Grandma no longer helped Mom with cleaning the boathouse or with making the food for my brother. and I. For Uncle Joe and Auntie Connie, for Mark and Mario are the cousins. In fact, she barely remembered our names nowadays. My other brother, Godwin, has only been to the boathouse on one day last summer with his girlfriend. He had spent most of the day whispering in her ear and shooting us embarrassed looks. Nowadays, nobody cared if I played with marbles, not even when I took a special blue and yellow one. I should watch our blue, Safra Lisbah, and Manla Bohadibis, so. It was redundant, calling your name to the sea in the middle of the night, as though somewhere between a splash against the rocks you'd answer me. In excess, like sprinkled sugar on sweet strawberries, I'd do it every night for nights in a row in search of an answer. Instead, the questions fought head to head, fizzing away from the sea foam, Malshane, Nazatlin, Malshane, Nalshane. When death comes, you expect it to be tragic. You think it will happen in the deep of night, in the middle of a storm. You think everyone and everything should stop, should listen, should close their eyes in silence. It doesn't happen that way. Nature is continuously prepared to simply go on. How fitting it was to lose you to the sea, where by my calculations you have spent a third of your life, lost in its mysterious beauty, bobbing and dipping at times. You seemed lost to us already then, when Mom's pleading would not get you out of the water until she got angry, Miskina Mama. Perhaps we should have known. Perhaps it shouldn't have been a surprise. For me, what's beautiful is the mundane, the everyday, the not the fireworks and the big special occasions or the big gestures. It's the details. So the mundane. I wrote about the same mundane moment some years apart. I'm going to read both versions. Amri Hatabuzbis. Amri Hatabuzbis. Ushemsh nizleb bit kwit dafa. Ajda utminya werba minuti. Ezat kifek liyush. Etar kifkelle grajun. O etmen disli nokli. Ajaj bitek rihiton. O amri disbi hinnum. Same poem. Called 8:04 p.m. It's Minya Werbamenoti, but it has taken quite a different perspective. When it came down to it, saying the words wasn't possible. A mouth full of clouds. All I had for you was a weak smile, white and low as the sky, a slow sunset, like many we've seen before. At 8:04 p.m., just like you said, painfully right again. I carried your heart home on that cloudy day, a day when I couldn't love you. So you see how a poem in 1 minute would mean a different poem, would be a different poem years later. Finally, the evolution of a writer, of a person, and how the words change, how the scenario changes. I'm going to be reading two poems from Inside Skin. A very special one to me. It's called Grey in the Dark, and it's it was written for my best friend when her father passed away. Very in the dark. As I held you, a little animal noise emerged. More of a vibration than a noise. Something shaking within you, that something shaking within me responded to. We cried together, as though in slow motion, in understanding, in friendship. Rain fell on the body we buried that night, a low, insidious metaphor of your tears. We lay on the ground in deep silence, holding hands, trying to get to the bottom of this question. What is it to be human when, breathless in the dark, we cannot understand the end? I'm going to read one last poem because I'm melting. For me, when I say I like a poem, I feel that it is successful in translating the initial feeling I had when I wanted to write a poem into words. Sometimes that process can take seconds. Sometimes it takes months. But when I say that I like this poem, and when I say that this poem or this piece of writing is successful, what I mean is that I have said what I wanted to say. That is it. And in this poem, I feel that I have said what I wanted to say. A new kind of courage. You give me a new kind of courage. You've seen me crawl out of my own skin, frustrated beyond words, shaking my fists and my beliefs at a world that just won't understand. Because who am I, and who are you? And what is it we are doing collectively that would matter at all? You've seen me rise out of the destruction of my own dreams, bright-eyed, brushing every bloody tear off my face in the way only long hot showers and music can. You've seen me run and crash and change direction, breathless, jaw clenched, eye circles that don't stop believing. You've seen me consistent and committed to the grave I started to dig in my own creation of a beautiful garden, and then smiled with conviction as I covered it up and I swore to you it will never happen again. And I believed it. And we both know that I am a fool. That is what I am. Thank you.